Your attention, please. And now, on with the show.
Live from Paradise Studios in New York, Strong Island Television presents Unger the Radar, starring Randy Unger.
Brought to you by Magnitude Jewelry. Add a two to match your attitude.
Tonight, we're going to be interviewing fashion influencer, TV personality, model, and philanthropist Simonetta Lane of the Amazon Prime show, The Wish Wall. Randy will also be discussing the best and worst films of 2019 with special guest critics Rachel Cole, Karen Bernardello, and Chris Clemente. And now, here's your host, Randy Unger.
Hey guys, I'm Randy Unger, and this is another edition of Unger the Radar, where we talk all things film. And right now, through Skype, I have media personality Simonetta Lane. Hey, Simonetta. Simonetta, lower your volume because we could hear your volume. Just mute it. Yeah, how's it going? Sorry for the little technical difficulties there.
No problem. I just see my image. Okay, it's frozen. No, it's
back. Okay. So, how are you this evening?
Very well. Thank you for asking. What about you?
Good. Thank you very much for taking the time tonight. This is very
Absolutely.
Cool.
Absolutely. Happy Sunday.
Yes, likewise. And I see you're in your kitchen.
Yes, you're in my kitchen, actually.
Oh, that's awesome.
I never show my house, but, you know, it's a special occasion because, like I was mentioning before, my mom is coming from Italy to see me after 2 years. I'm not being seen here, so it's, you know, really house warming feelings today.
Bellissimo, right? That's great. So, you're a fashion influencer, TV personality, model, philanthropist, you do it all. What's it like wearing so many hats, and do you have a favorite?
It is a little bit stressing, I'll be honest, because of course you have to, like I was saying, have so many hats, but maybe my favorite, I mean, if I can choose two, it's definitely my fashion world into Instagram. I really love to be there. Okay. And the other side, it's my foundation, my heart, all the stuff that I've been doing for, especially for women all around the world. So that makes me very, very proud.
And that is the Wish Wall, correct?
Yes, the Wish Wall Foundation.
That's all.
Perfect.
Talk a little bit about that, because are you a genie? Is that essentially what you are?
I don't know. I mean, no, I think I'm just a regular person who has a lot of to, you know, give maybe. And on the other side, it also gives back to me, because when I see, you know, real people that actually, you know, that I can in a way impact their life in a positive way, trust me, it actually changed my life. And I started, I didn't even know when I started this process that it would have been, so beautiful for myself, because it has started, actually from, believe it or not, it started through Vanity Fair. I was more glamorous at the beginning. It was, literally, I was interviewing celebrities through Vanity Fair about the power of wishes, and because I publish a novel about it, and so because of that I started to ask celebrity how do they achieve their goals and their dreams. That's how it started. But then I was, you know, kind of missing the everyday interaction with everyday people. And that's actually how it started. I said, let me open a blog where basically everyone can write their own wish. And then from that I started to, you know, be involved every year more and more into women empowerment and projects all around the world. It's just beautiful because through the Wish Wall, people write me, and when I see a project that I actually can support and that impacts a community, I try to do so. So that's how it started.
That's so noble. That's such a beautiful cause.
Thank you.
I'm curious, what was the first wish that you tackled?
Oh, so it, like I was saying, during the year that's changed drastically, meaning that at the very beginning, it was more, I don't want to call it superficial, because to me, every wish is not superficial, but, you know, they were writing me, hey, you know that singer, can I have an autograph, you know, or hi, you know, I really would like to meet that, I don't know, football player, soccer player, whatever. So that was at the beginning. And then when I started to actually really create the Wishful Foundation, because like I said, at the beginning it was a blog, then it went more into projects. So maybe the very first one I remember that I granted, it's actually for people that I've never met, that I would never meet. And, you know, in a way I impacted their lives, you know, as a, you know, someone far away from them, but that was also kind of special, you know, really to give, just to give. So the very first one, I believe it was for a father who lost his job and he just wanted to fly. And he never flew in his entire life. So we arranged that. And so that was maybe the very first one. And then after that, instead, like I said, I had, you know, several on that type of wishes, but after that it became more like projects. And so, for instance, for a woman who lives in Florida, who has a big truck that converted in a mobile clinic, and she goes around for Florida trying to help, you know, people who don't have, you know, health insurance. And so that was one of the projects. Then we went in the Philippines and we helped 180 children, giving them like a special day and giving them all the school tools. And then also their very first ice cream. I still remember their faces. And then from that, I moved into Africa. I've been doing a lot of projects in Africa, actually, lately. We've been doing actually a literacy award called, after my name, the Simonetta Lean Literacy Award. That was for 100 girls. Wow. And then after that, another big prize for 200 children. And then after that, another huge project for women entrepreneurs in Africa. So, you know, it's evolving and increasing.
So it sounds like you have a lot of wish makers. Would you call them clients? And if so, how many do you think you have overall?
Oh, no. Those are not my clients. So the okay. clients that I have are through my fashion world.
Okay.
When I am the wish maker, I'm just, you know, and honestly, it's my volunteer work. I volunteer completely to this. So I don't know. I know that I've granted many, many wishes, definitely thousands. Okay. So I don't know how many, but, you know, you can go to the wishful.org and you can see all the wishes that we publish every single day. And go to our pages and see. So, like I said, that is maybe, you know, one of my favorite hats to wear, because, you know, it gives me a lot of joy.
And would you say that being a fashion model is a close second?
Yes, because that is more my creative part. So, you know, modeling and interpreting a brand, interpreting a campaign. Now, very soon, I will be also modeling New York Fashion Week again. I've done Madison Square Garden. I've done, like, big things. And that is, you know, again, my creative side. And, you know, it gives me also a lot of joy. But in a different way, you know, different energy.
Right. You're so great. You have a great energy. You're so busy. This is crazy.
Oh, yes. I'm busy. And like I said, my mom is coming. So I'm excited.
Nice. Well, I won't keep you. Last question. What advice do you have for young, aspiring businesswomen out there?
To really work hard. Like, for instance, tomorrow, like I said, my mom is here, but I'm still shooting. Actually, she'll come to the, you know, photo shoot with me. Work hard. I mean, I work even like today, it's Sunday, but not because you have to, but because you really want to.
Yeah.
And that, to me, is a key. It seems, you know, very easy to say, but you really have to find your niche and, you know, your source of inspiration, in my opinion, and really go for it so that, you know, you're always working and you're never working, like my grandfather used to say.
Nice. And so the Wish Wall, that's on Amazon Prime, or it's coming out soon?
Yes, it's already out on Amazon Prime, and also it's now worldwide on Apple TV through FNL Network. So please go and check it out.
That's so cool. Simon, anything else you want to plug or mention at this time?
I think, again, let's be tuned. New York Fashion Week, you'll see me, you know, doing an amazing catwalk for amazing designer Stevie Boy. So I really, you know, I'm excited about that. So follow me, you know, during.
Okay, great. Well, Simon, thank you. thank you so much for your time. Also, if you're ever in New York, we'd love to have you stop by the studio.
That would be great. That would be great, actually.
Awesome. Well, we'll talk more, but best of luck to you, and say hi to your mom for me.
Thank you. Gonna cook me some. I'm excited.
Great. All the best. Thanks, Simonetta.
Bye. Bye-bye.
Bye. Okay, guys, so we're going to take a short commercial break, but we'll be back with our film review segment right after this.
Under the Radar is brought to you by Magnitude Jewelry. Add a 2 to match your attitude. Patent pending interchange genuine gemstone and crystal EMF protection jewelry. For more information, please visit magnitudejewelry.com/gemgirl or call 718-268-6634.
And we're back. Hey guys, this is Under the Radar, where we talk all things film. And we are here with a wonderful panel of guest critics. We have Rachel Kolb. Hello.
Hello.
Karen Benedello. Sorry.
Hey.
And Chris Clemente. Hey. It's been a while since I've seen you guys.
I know.
I don't think any of you have been at the new set.
No, I like it.
It's not so new anymore, actually. It's a few months.
I know. I like it, though. It's get the sick.
Yeah. You know, it's very stable. It's good. Mm-hmm.
We have an argument with me.
Yeah, that's why I picked it. I mean, come on. So we've got a lot to cover, guys. Mm-hmm. 2019 was a big year for film, thankfully.
Yeah.
And I just want to go by the shame list first. Mm-hmm. So I should tell everybody we've got five categories of film tonight. We've got the shame list, which is all movies that have been critically acclaimed or widely acclaimed by audiences that we sadly did not get a chance to see.
Sadly.
Yep. But we're going to mention them today. And then we've got the worst list, which is the worst of the year. Honorable mentions, films that did not make the cut on the top 10. Mm-hmm. And then we have the top 10, our favorite films of the year. Favorite/best. It's like kind of a gray line, yep. You know?
Right. What makes it different for you?
Well, favorite can be like a sentimental film. Like for me, Ghostbusters 2 is my favorite movie, mm-hmm. but I know it's not the best movie ever made. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. In that vein, I would maybe put like Glengarry Glen Ross or Back to the Future, something like that.
Okay.
So that's top 10, and then we're going to finish things off with anticipated films for 2020. Mm-hmm. So, all right, we've got a lot to cover. Shame list. Let's do this. So what didn't I get to see? What didn't I get to see? You know what?
You saw everything, right?
I know. Well, what did you not see that you wanted to see?
Okay, so there were quite a few that I missed out on this year. 1917 is probably one of the biggest. Mm. That is definitely next up on my list. I will be getting to that before the Oscars. Mm-hmm. I also have Jojo Rabbit, Queen and Slim, The Dead Don't Die, Art of Self-Defense, which I saw is just now on Hulu. So,
oh, yes.
So I can finally get to that one. Peanut Butter Falcon, Honey Boy, I got Shia LaBeouf in there. Pain and Glory, Beautiful Day in the Neighborhood, How to Train Your Dragon, The Hidden World, which is also on Hulu. The Farewell, very much anticipated for me. I just haven't had time. Last Black Man in San Francisco, Hustlers, Dr. Sleep, and Just Mercy.
Wow, it's a huge list.
Yes.
Just to put it out there.
Yeah.
Just so that we can be on
I think
the
for
same
me,
level ground.
The Art of Self-Defense, I know that's on your top, one of your tops.
Maybe.
But yeah, I didn't get to see that, unfortunately. And mm-hmm. That one really sticks with me. Yeah, it's weird. Like, when I did this list, I saw a lot of these, actually, to be honest with you. Karen, anything that you didn't get to see that you want to see?
There's a few that I didn't see. I didn't see 1917. I want to see that one as well.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
I got to interview Sam Mendes at Comic-Con. They did, like, a red carpet, so that was exciting. Yeah. So that was pretty cool, and, like, the cast was there, so looking forward to it. And
how's he as a person?
He was pretty cool. He was, like, really open and stuff. Like, I wasn't sure, like, if I get to talk to him because there were, like, a lot of people there, but he kind of went to everyone, so I'm like, okay, cool. That was pretty good. That was
a great experience. A good amount of time with him?
It was, like, maybe 2 or 3 minutes because he was going around to everybody, but it was pretty cool. So
that was
back in October, so I'm like, okay, now I have to see the movie, and nice. So that's like one of the
still
top
have
ones.
To see the movie.
Yeah, so.
Yeah, I hear you.
Oh, here's one for me. Ready or Not. I did not get a chance to see one of you.
You didn't miss
Karen. Much. You liked it. Was number 8 for you.
Yeah, I'm into like horror movies and stuff. So as I was saying before, like horror movies, I like kind of the more serious, not really horror comedies. Like this one's a horror comedy, but I really liked it because I thought the humor.
Yeah,
was really
you don't really see much of that. Yeah. Right? But and I liked it. I saw it. I liked it up till where it kind of shifted gears a little bit and turned into a different genre of movie. That was a cop out at the end, but
all right,
it was cool nonetheless.
And another shame for me, Little Women.
Which is on my list.
It's on your top 10?
Yes, nice. It is number 2 on my top 10 list.
Wow. Yep.
That is quite a spot there.
I haven't seen it yet either. No. I want to.
I love the cast. It's like Meryl Streep. I could never pronounce her name. Saoirse Ronan.
It's
fantastic.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Emma Watson, of course, Laura Dern, who is in numerous movies that are up for Best Picture
and
this year.
She will probably win an Oscar
for
Marriage Story.
Yeah, and I'm going to continue to believe that she's nominated for Little Women, but that's just me. She did great in both films, but I think she is much superior in Little Women.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Mm. That's good to know. Mm-hmm. Guys, any more shame?
I have a whole bunch of
rattle them off. Let's hear it.
Big one for me, I didn't get to see, is Parasite. I
know
it's making a ton of lists, and it's unfortunate.
I haven't seen that one yet either.
I felt like there was such a short window by where I was that I didn't get to see it.
It's a great film. I don't want to say it's a little overrated, but it is a little bit.
I disagree with that.
Maybe I'm going to rewatch it, assess, and we'll figure it out, but it is getting a lot of acclaim.
Yep.
It is excellent, though.
Midsummer, The Lighthouse, I know, Little Woman, Women, rather, Jojo Rabbit, Peanut Butter Falcon, I know.
Oh, my God.
That's on yours.
Number
you
one,
love
actually.
It. I know. Queen and Slim, and 1917, which I might argue could be a 2020 film.
Right. Well,
But
it did come out in a limited release on Christmas.
I know, but
it's such
a scapegoat just to make it into the Oscars. But the wider release was in January, so.
True.
Back when The Revenant was out, I kind of did that.
But that
kinda,
did come out in December.
I hate when they do that, but.
Yeah. And Titanic, guys, don't forget.
Yeah, yeah.
Anything
that Leo is in, I guess.
Yeah. So. It's like the best films of the year usually come out in the fall to winter of the end of the year, so.
Yeah.
I don't know why.
But that's going to be the next theater going experience to see that. I have to see that. Oh 19, my gosh.
So it was, I think it's number 2 for me on my list. Yeah.
Cool.
Loved it. Mendes did a fantastic job. It might be my second favorite war film next to Saving Private Ryan.
Yeah,
I think it's that good.
It's just
It just you really are invested in the characters and you want to see what's going to happen.
Yeah,
and to get that absorbed and sucked into a movie that's the ultimate movie experience.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
and 1970 did that for me. So
nice.
Yeah.
Wow.
See it on the big screen for sure.
Yeah, I mean, there's so many great war movies out, like Dunkirk. I was in love with. So
yeah. This has a similar pacing to it.
Like
Dunkirk. Yeah. But anyway, we got so much
shame.
More to cover.
Yes. Enough of shame. Let's.
Oh, another shame. Bombshell. I did not.
I haven't seen that one either.
You like the makeup effects, right?
Yes. I will say the performances were all pretty solid. The movie overall is okay. Mm. It's fine. But by far the standout is the makeup and prosthetics work, particularly on.
John Lithgow.
Well, John Lithgow I would say John Lithgow.
It just made him, like, look fatter.
Yeah, I mean, if you've seen Roger Ailes, like, he definitely looks like Roger Ailes. But the one that's the most uncanny is Charlize as Megyn Kelly.
Huh.
Between the voice and the prosthetics, it's really scary how close she got.
Oh, wow.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah,
but I've been hearing great things about it, and, I love all the actors involved. Mm-hmm. All right, so guys, are we good with shame list?
We're good with shame.
Yes. All right.
It's off of us now.
No more shame at this. We're good. Worst of the year. I think Chris and I, we share one of these films.
Yes.
and it involves a certain creature of the 50s.
Yeah.
Godzilla, yeah, King of the Monsters.
Yeah, I just, wow. It was just lackluster.
Yeah.
And I love monster movies. I love Godzilla. Yeah. I was pumped up to go see it. I'm still kind of pumped up to see Godzilla versus King Kong when that comes out.
Sure, that could be epic.
I love Skull Island, but it was just really flat. And
yeah.
I believe I fell asleep in the theater too.
Even with all the roaring and explosions.
Yeah, it was just white noise after a while.
Yeah, it was disappointing.
Yeah, it was.
Because I mean, I know going into it, you're expecting like this huge spectacle, and that's what it was.
Yeah.
But enough already. You know, I wanted a little more of the girl from Stranger Things, like her backstory.
Yeah. Millie Bobby Brown.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you.
Yep.
And it was just too much. It was it's just an obnoxious summer blockbuster. That's all it is.
I forgot a lot of it now, but I remember like just the fight scene. Like you were just waiting for that monster fight, and I remember it just being a total letdown. So.
Yeah, I'd rather watch Matthew Broderick's the Godzilla movie from the 90s.
Yeah,
I'd rather watch that.
That's so bad that it's kind of good.
I think it's a little bit better than this. Mm-hmm. That's not saying much.
And you also had Charles Dance, who's probably best known for Game of Thrones,
right?
Being a prolific actor as it is. But the most positive thing that he said about Godzilla was complimenting the craft services. So that kind of gave us a clue there about what we're getting.
Yeah, it's unfortunate, but I'm still kind of pumped up to see Godzilla versus King Kong.
Well, I love Skull Island, too. I know that was just a fun movie. I don't know why this kind of fell flat. You know?
Yeah.
But Kong versus Godzilla has potential, I guess.
Yeah.
But, you know, I think one of the more interesting things about Skull Island was the character, the human characters.
Mm. I forgot.
Yeah, this one had forgettable characters. I think Bryan Cranston was in the first Godzilla.
Yeah, and he's barely in it.
Yeah. So you had these fantastic.
And then it's like, let's go over to Aaron Taylor-Johnson's character, who is just, cares, really.
Yeah, you have these fantastic actors in this terrible movie. It's just a paycheck for them, unfortunately. Mm-hmm. Anyway, Karen, hello. Worst film of the year?
Trying to think which one. Godzilla, I didn't actually see, so I guess I
was good
on that one.
Yeah, yeah. Maybe one of the screening links I subjected you to during the year. Because there's a lot.
Well, if I can jump in, because
please.
I definitely know what my worst of is. Which,
here we go.
My worst of was actually one that I watched for the show, which was The Best of Enemies.
You know what? That wasn't terrible in my book. Taraji P. Henson.
Oh, that movie.
Sam Rockwell.
I saw the Blu-ray when I was walking through Target the other day, and I just kind of wanted to pick it up and turn it around. So
No one would buy it. That's funny.
It was... That movie is not going to hold up well. I tell you that much.
It's a true story. It's historical.
I think there's a documentary actually about it that would probably.
That's probably better than
you're
watching.
Not saving it, Randy. You're not saving it.
Well, I try to watch anything Sam Rockwell's in because he's one of my favorite working actors.
Yeah.
But yeah, it was kind of a letdown.
The biggest problem is the framing of the movie, and that there's characters in it that you're like, I want to know more about John Gallagher Jr.'s character. He's like the hero of this thing. He's someone that's actually making sacrifices to do the right thing. And Sam Rockwell's character basically does the wrong thing all the way up until he finally does the one right thing. That's the same right thing that John Gallagher Jr.'s character and other characters have done all along. So it's just like you get a prize for the one time that you weren't a total racist.
That just erases your entire history of being a jerk and
horrible person. And being active in the KKK. KKK member.
Well, it's definitely not Black Klansman, because that's far superior.
Definitely.
Well, apparently he doesn't want to do any more racist movies, right?
Rockwell?
Like, Rockwell is like... coined now as like the go-to racist.
For three billboards.
Jojo Rabbit, he's a Nazi.
He's
kind of typecast.
Like, like Richard Jewell comes along, he's like, yeah, sure.
He's always kind of a slimy character, kind of, if you think about it. Even in Galaxy Quest, he was a little...
Galaxy Quest, he's nobody. He's a nobody.
He doesn't have a last name. What am I doing here?
What was it? A couple years ago, he made this low-budget movie. I think it was called Long Shot, or
That was this year with Seth Rogen.
No.
Oh, different one.
Not that. Or like a Buckshot or something.
Oh, he's a basketball coach for high school girls.
No. He's a local Southerner who's he's hunting and he shoots a guy by mistake. So
I think I remember that. Yeah.
And not only that, but like he finds a large sum of money on this guy. So you know, it's like it's a moral dilemma. Should he take the money and do right by his family because he's kind of poor?
Kind of like A Simple Plan.
Great movie. Yeah.
22 years late, but okay.
So good.
Not on this list.
Yeah. But a great movie.
Yeah.
Great movie. Yeah. And he's not slimy.
Okay.
Long shot, night shot, something shot.
I know. I remember. It's like a sniper rifle, right?
Yeah.
That's his weapon.
Yeah. I actually went to the premiere with that. He was there. He's cool.
Oh, cool.
Nice. Wish I could remember.
I met him for a small film he did.
Yeah,
a few years ago. Loitering with Intent.
Yeah.
Straight up indie film.
Yeah.
And
he had a cool shot with him, too.
Yeah. I met him and the filmmakers. And Marissa Tomei was there, too.
Nice.
That was an awesome, not a great film, but a great experience seeing them all.
You got to respect him because he takes risks.
Yeah. You know? No, and he's just a super cool guy in person, too.
Yeah.
Also, I don't want to spend too much on this one. The Man Who Killed Hitler and then the Bigfoot. Starring Sam Elliott.
Yeah, another one that's available on Hulu.
Wow.
That was just terrible. I only have two films on my worst list because it's just too painful.
I have a couple, but
the
worst of my worst is MIB International. I was so disappointed because I loved the series way back when, but I felt like, you know, they really demolished the franchise. And it just goes to show, sometimes you just gotta let a franchise
run its course.
You know, run its course and you know, be gone, and that's it.
Yeah, this is sort of like a spin-off type of.
Yeah. I mean,
pseudo sequel.
Yeah, they wanted to get Thor while he was off of Thor, and you know, they wanted to just kind of make it bigger by making it international. And
was it the same filmmakers or just Hemsworth and Tessa Thompson? Were those the only Thor correlations?
I don't know.
It was just a terrible movie. I'm with you on that one. The only redeeming quality is probably the visual and makeup effects and Danny Elfman's music.
Yeah, that's true.
Danny Elfman.
The elf was there. Yeah.
It's a great theme.
Not enough to revive the movie, though.
Yeah, it didn't really help things. Okay, are we good with the worst?
There's only one other that I will give a quick mention to because I know that one of my worst is on your best list. This one is not on anybody's list though. Serenity. Did anyone see Serenity?
I know McConaughey and
Anne Hathaway.
Hathaway, right?
Yes. This movie, you guys, if you have not seen it or you don't know the twist in it, it is. Like, you will not see it coming. And it is
but
the
they're
dumbest.
Both great actors. They're really good actors.
It's one of the dumbest twists I've ever seen in a movie. It's so
what's
bad.
What's this movie about?
What's the premise?
Because I feel like if I try to explain the premise now, it will actually give away the twist. But basically,
we're all on the edge of our seats right now.
But basically, Matthew McConaughey's on this island, and there's some stuff going on, and he's always running around on these little missions and stuff. And then he realizes...
Is it deserted?
There are other people around, but then he makes a realization that turns it into the dumbest movie you've ever seen. It's like number 23 bad twist, or like knowing, or like, you know, it's just so Serenity.
23.
That's like Jim Carrey, right?
Yeah. One of the only Jim Carrey movies.
It looks so dark, I'm kind of scared.
It's
to
bad.
Watch
yeah.
it.
Yeah, that was the first movie that I actually wanted to destroy the DVD after I saw it. Even though I rented it. Like, I was like, I just don't want anyone else to have to see this. But
I saw that one in the theater. I was sitting there like, what is happening?
But I will say Serenity is fun for if you want to do like a bad movie night
and
with lots of alcohol. It's one that you can enjoy and just kind of discover together and be like, what are we watching?
Right.
Otherwise, it's one of the worst movies.
Oh, wow. Serenity, definitely the opposite of Serenity, it sounds like.
Yes.
Now, are you going to mention your other one?
I only have one other. Which is Joker.
I remember the last time we were on together, the top 10. There was a cartoon that you loathed, because it had
Zootopia.
Some.
No, it wasn't Zootopia.
No, I think because it had some moral issues. I think it was like
An animated
with, what's his face from Arrested Development? Will Arnett.
Oh.
The dog show one.
Yes.
The one that got pulled from theaters.
Yeah.
Yes.
What was the title?
Yeah.
Oh my
gosh.
That
made your worst list, right?
That one made my worst list. Yeah. Yes, because it ended up getting pulled from theaters.
Yeah.
It wasn't animated though. I think
he
was doing the voice of a dog, but I think the dog was like CG.
Oh, okay.
And but no, like this movie's now kind of famous because of the fact that it got pulled from theaters.
Oh my gosh.
Yes.
Well, like I feel like the reason for this pick is kind of like the same moral compass that you're...
And I will say that I do think that Joaquin's great. I think he does really great in it.
It's Show Dogs, by the way.
Show Dogs.
Show Dogs.
Yes.
Sorry.
But overall, like I really despise who this movie is trying to target. I don't like the general overall feel of the movie. It's never one that I want to watch again. The experience of watching it was unpleasant.
Mm-hmm.
Honestly, Todd Phillips, since this movie has started getting nominated for things, has said a lot of stupid stuff for the press. I'm also irritated that he is in the same category as Greta Gerwig for adapted screenplay, which they're not even close as far as quality, and he's in best director.
And isn't the screenplay there's two nominations for Joker to get screenplay, so
I
it's like
know.
They have two shots at screenplay.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep.
Huh. Yeah. Okay.
Well, it's just usually the director is the writer or the producer is
the
writer.
Two writers on the screenplay on both of them.
Yeah.
Well, yeah. Okay. Okay.
Yep. Not a worst list. That's on your worst. That's number one on your worst list. Wow.
So you felt like it was doing injustice to those that are mentally ill, or?
Yeah. Oh, that was a big part of it. Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Yes. Okay. I feel like the way that it portrays mental illness is very irresponsible. I think that it demonizes people with mental illness, if anything, which is weird because it seems like the movie and Joaquin, the way he's playing it, he wants to bring some sympathy, but then everything turns violent and horrible, and it's like, well, how is this supposed to help anything? Anyone?
But it is the Joker, which is the quintessential villainous character.
Yeah.
So it's like you have to balance that tenderness or that realism that he wants to give that schema of society versus the bombastic. All right, this is the Batman.
Yeah,
villain
look at it from that point of view. Not like it's a commentary on society or anything. It's just a comic book movie.
But that's the thing though, is that it seems like Todd Phillips wants it to be both. He wants to have it both ways. He wants it to be this social commentary and be a real movie and not like those dumb other comic book movies. But at the same time, doesn't want to take any responsibility for the messages that he's putting into his own movie.
Uh-huh. So the movie itself is bipolar, in a way.
Maybe a little bit. And I also have a huge problem with the fact that it draws that it's like, oh, look, he is just as persecuted as these other people in this movie that that have certain societal disadvantages, that he's put on the same level as someone like, say, a single mother who's also a woman of color. It's that's not the same thing, and those are different struggles. And I also have to say that the ending and the tie-in with Batman made me very angry and was completely unnecessary in the last sequence, which I'm sure you guys all know what I'm talking about. Probably the most positive thing about that last sequence was I recognized where they were filming it, which was over in Jersey City, not far from where I live. So that was kind of fun. But otherwise, I guess that was a good distraction from what was actually happening on screen.
No, that's interesting. And I totally understand where you're coming from. Mm-hmm. But I feel like the realism that I was trying to play was something different. And if anything, it was kind of calling out or giving a little bit of heart to mental illness, and even a call out to say, hey, when government institutes get lack of funding, this is what kind of happens.
But it seems like he throws that in there that it's like, oh, the funding's getting cut. and then doesn't actually explore anything mm-hmm. past that, which is why a lot of people are drawing comparisons to things like Taxi Driver.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Rightfully yeah. so, because it's clear that Todd Phillips took a lot of inspiration from mm-hmm. that.
And Martin Scorsese was, at once upon a time, tied to this movie.
Yes. Yeah.
And there's yeah. a lot of The Last King of Comedy parallels and yeah. with, you know, De Niro is the yeah, talk yeah. show host now, yeah. 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 aspiring comedian. You know.
But it's just, it all comes off as a bit artificial, that it's just like he wants the appearance of, oh, we're going to talk about government funding, we're going to talk about mental illness, but it's not actually going to dig under the surface at all. It's just all going to be very surface level cosmetic.
Uh-huh. Okay. So,
what about aesthetically, yeah. like the film visually, how did it strike
you?
No?
That movie is ugly, and I know that was the intention. That
it's
was
very
clearly
orange.
The intention, because there's supposed to be trash everywhere because of the strikes that are going on with the garbage yeah. within the movie, but again, it makes it so unpleasant to
yeah.
watch.
Okay. It's almost like a 70s New York vibe. Like,
I mean,
yeah. like
more,
a
more like, yeah, 70s,
yeah.
80s.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Karen, what did you think of Joker?
I kind of agree with kind of what both of you guys are saying, but like, what really kind of struck me was Joaquin's performance.
Yeah.
Like,
mm-hmm.
everything else, I think, like, kind of like what you were saying about, like, the mental illness was kind of more service level, but his performance, I think, was really kind of what made the movie stand out mm-hmm. to me
yeah.
and
yeah.
kind of
mm-hmm.
got onto my top 10 list,
yeah.
but, like, I think he's definitely going to win the Oscar for that as
oh,
well.
Oh, yeah, I think mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think he's on the path to win the Oscar
yeah.
at this
fantastic.
Point.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
All right, guys. So, Joker.
Yes.
All righty. Some honorable mentions, I think. Wait, is that where
yes,
we're at?
Yes, I think we're at honorable mentions.
Yeah.
Good. Moving right along. For me, I'll just rattle them all. The Lighthouse, awesome movie. Queen and Slim, Jojo Rabbit, Beautiful Day in the Neighborhood. The Nightingale, I don't know if you guys
ooh,
saw it.
I did
you
see
did
Nightingale,
see that.
Yes.
Ooh,
I
this is a
actually
guy.
Completely
ooh.
Forgot.
It's a twist. It's a dark, twisty, what's like 1700s, 1600s, 1700s?
Yeah, yeah, where they're basically, they were sentenced for a crime, and they're like working off their sentence.
Right, and this woman
yeah.
who's a prisoner in this camp, she has children, and there's some murders, there's some rapes. And
yes.
It's very gratuitous. It's harsh. It's like really difficult
yeah.
to watch.
Yeah.
But I think it was really well made.
Yeah, and mm-hmm. it's from the writer-director who did Babadook.
Okay, ooh. You're right, you're right.
Yes, yes.
Very quality horror thriller.
Yeah, it is a very harsh movie, especially
yeah.
if you are sensitive to sexual violence. It is a very hard movie to watch.
I think some people walked out in the screening.
Like, yeah.
This woman was like, I can't watch this. And then she just walks out.
Mm-hmm.
But
yes.
I stayed. I was like, okay, I get where she's at, but I'm kind of curious where they're going to go with this. So.
Yeah.
And it's just, it's a very strong film.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't actually see it, but I did see the Babadook, and I thought that one was overrated. I didn't like it.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Ooh.
Oh, look, well, the monster design
so
is
you're not
going
to
cool.
run to go see that.
Also on the list, Making Waves, The Art of Cinematic Sound. It's a documentary that was screened at Tribeca.
Cool.
It talks about sound design and music and the relationship and the filmmaking process. It was great. Basically,
they explore certain movies, or
yeah, like Apocalypse Now was focused on a lot of Star Wars and all
oh, okay.
that. A lot of movies from
really
the '70s.
Cool.
Yeah,
yeah,
yeah, especially like you know Dolby and THX
yeah.
and all that. It's
cool.
Good time for sound. General Magic. It's another documentary about the birth of the smartphone, basically from like the early to mid '90s,
mm-hmm.
where a small company called General Magic kind of put together the blueprint to create the iPhone, basically. And it has interviews with like software engineers, hardware engineers, you know, different people involved with the process.
Cool.
General Magic. It's very
General Magic.
Yeah, I didn't think I'd like it, but it's illuminating. It's
yeah.
educational.
That's the thing with documentaries, you know, like you
yeah.
don't know how much you're gonna love it until you just go ahead and see
yeah,
it.
Just
yeah.
do it. If
yeah.
you're mildly interested in the subject,
yeah, just do it. Yeah.
Do it.
Yeah.
If you have the time, it's great.
Yeah.
Toy Story 4, honorable mm-hmm. mention.
That's also an honorable mention for
okay,
me.
Okay, good.
Well. Yep.
Rocket Man. Not as good as Bohemian Rhapsody, but still a fun time.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if you guys saw.
I still haven't.
Okay.
I actually had heard the opposite. I heard that Rocket Man was better than Bohemian Rhapsody. So
that's
I'm
very interesting.
I'm excited to see it.
Yeah,
yeah.
No, Taron Egerton knocks it out of the park. He's
mm-hmm.
terrific.
Yeah.
Not, you know, Oscar caliber, but
mm-hmm.
just a quality performance. And something I'm surprised I didn't see on your guys' list, everybody. Fighting with My Family.
I did not see that one either.
It's I liked it quite
it's an
a bit.
honorable.
Earlier on in the year, it was on my top 10. So
yeah.
Just it kind of bumped down.
Okay.
So, yeah.
But it's just a fun movie.
Yeah, it was a solid movie.
Yeah. It's filled with heart.
Yeah.
I can't say the same for the next one on my list, Lords of Chaos.
Okay.
Which is basically about this. I think it's Kieran Culkin, who becomes like a death metal head in 1980s. I don't know where he is, but...
Sweden.
Yeah. Thank you. Yeah, thank you, Karen.
Actually, I got to interview him, actually.
Oh, you did?
Yeah,
really?
Yeah, so
that's
a
good
interesting
one.
Yeah.
It was just a very dark and comedic film. And what did you think, actually?
I didn't really know too much about it. It was like kind of based on a true story of a real group. So when I was watching it, I'm like, this is very interesting. And I can't really picture anyone else but him in it.
Yeah, he's pretty great. Yeah. And the other guy, too, who was in it, even better, who... It's crazy. There's death metal music, there's murder, there's sex, there's drugs. It's just a crazy movie.
Wow.
But, yeah, it fell through the cracks this year.
Pumping.
Lords of Chaos, guys.
I'm like, this is a weird character, and he did it perfectly.
He
was great to talk to. I interviewed him, like, a few years ago at Tribeca.
Kieran, right?
Yeah.
That's cool.
So then this was, like, the second time I got to talk to him. So, like, well, he definitely fit into that role really well.
Yeah,
so.
It was written for him, pretty much. Mm-hmm. Anyone else? Did we do everyone's honorables?
No, did you go? Okay. This is
sorry, guys. The line. Everything's blurring right now.
Yeah, no. We're just having fun.
We are.
This is literally the 11 through 15 on my list. So it just at one point in time they were in the top 10. So they just got bumped down.
Gotcha.
The Farewell. The Two Popes. Joker. mostly for Joaquin Phoenix's performance. El Camino. It's the ending to Breaking Bad.
Nice.
Saw that in the theater. That was awesome to see in the theater because there are just some great landscape shots and some great urban shots that you don't appreciate.
They should just screen the entire series on a big screen, at the IFC Center or Nighthawk. One of those guys. Listen, Breaking Bad the marathon. I love it.
Yeah. I would be there in
the flesh. Camp out.
And The Dead Don't Die. Love that movie.
I wanted to love it. It didn't impress me. I was expecting a Shaun of the Dead vibe.
It was fun. The ending was really weird and very meta, but who cares? I loved it.
Yeah. I didn't end up seeing that one. I'm like, I don't know. It didn't really interest me, so I'm like, I'm going to skip it.
Adam Driver's, his character in that was just hilarious.
This was his year. This was totally Adam Driver's year.
Yep.
With four big films.
Yeah.
This, Star Wars, Marriage Story, and The Report. I didn't see it.
Yep.
That one was pretty good. He was really good in it. It was like he carried the whole movie. So.
That's great.
Yeah, I think the only people that come close are Laura Dern, Keith Stanfield. Also, he's in Uncut Gems and in Knives Out.
That's on my top 10, actually. Is that on your...
Uncut Gems?
Yeah, what is that on?
That is on my top 10.
Nice.
Yes.
I have to see that one.
Okay, you're in for a treat. It's on your top 10.
It is. Adam Sandler should have... Well, he's getting awards elsewhere, but he should have gotten an Oscar nod.
I know, he was... Yeah, he was snubbed, I'd say.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Has he ever been nominated for an Oscar?
No.
Not even for Rain Over. Rain Over Me was pretty decent.
I felt like it just came and left. I don't think it deserved.
Punch Dark Love was probably the closest she's gotten to so far.
Well, that was the first time I ever remember him being dramatic.
Yeah.
He's got some acting chops.
He's almost like Jim Carrey, where it's like when put him in with the right director and the right dramatic role,
he
could do a lot with
it. I feel John Candy or Chris Farley, if they lived long enough, they could have gotten to that level of dramatic
acting. You know? Definitely John Candy.
Because wasn't he like Uncle Buck? He had some serious moments.
Yeah. Oh my god, I love that movie. I just watched it.
I mean, Planes, Trains.
Oh my god!
Just the emotion in that.
Just his eyes.
Great screenplay in that movie, by the way.
Mm-hmm. Chris Farley, I think. Well, he died too early to.
He was too crazy.
I don't think he ever kind of touched drama.
No.
Yeah.
But he had potential to do it.
Maybe Tommy Boy. Maybe Tommy. A little bit.
Yeah.
A little bit.
Okay.
Anyway, that was my honorable mention.
Okay. Yeah. Karen, any honorable mentions for you?
I think you guys pretty much covered it.
Very good. Well, I think that's a good time for a commercial break, right?
Yeah.
Alrighty. So guys, stay tuned for our top 10 list right after this.
Under the Radar is brought to you by Magnitude Jewelry add a tude to match your attitude. Patent pending, interchange genuine gemstone and crystal EMF protection jewelry. For more information, please visit magnitudejewelry.com/gemgirl or call 718-268-6634.
Guys, so Rachel, I apologize for jumping the gun there. What are your honorable mentions?
Okay, I'm going to keep
best for last. Right?
Yes. Okay. So my honorable mentions for this past year, I wanted to give a shout out to these few performances from the movie Cats, which has generally been panned, by reviewers, which understandably so. But okay. I do believe that these four actors gave really excellent performances. Ian McKellen. Who plays Gus the theater cat, Stephen McCrae, who's kind of the narrator for the whole thing. Stephen McCrae is Scrimbleshanks the railway cat, which I put to all of you in the group text, and nobody could name
I was kind of close with Squibbles.
With Squibbles. Robbie Fairchild, who is kind of the narrator for the thing, and Jason Derulo as Rum Tum Tugger. Also most unexpected good performance from an actor that I expected nothing from.
What about Judi Dench?
Or
Idris. Judi Dench. She talks directly to the audience.
Oh, yeah. And she played a transgender cat? Where is that?
Don't even get me started on that nonsense. The LGBTQ community does not need to get dragged into all that. That was a real messed up for her, in my opinion. Yeah. Then I have Brad Pitt in Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. That movie did not make my top 10 list, but I do think that his performance will win, and I think it will be deserved.
Yeah.
I feel like you're the Armin White of the group. Like, you're the contrarian. No. I love it.
Okay, so, and then I've got Lego Movie 2, the second part, which I felt got very much overlooked, came out early this year.
Not as good as the first, in my opinion.
Yes, I think it's telling a very different type of story, though, and I appreciate the story it's telling, and I also think the song from it is extremely catchy. Also, I want to give a shout-out to the character of Susan in Missing Link, which did not make my top 10 or my honorable mentions as a whole, but I love that character. I think he is wonderful, and I would love to see a Missing Link 2 and 3 with just the adventures of Susan and the Explorer.
I've heard good things about Missing Link. Is that a Wallace and Gromit type?
It's it's by Leica Studios,
okay.
Who did Paranorman, who did Box Trolls,
Okay. Like in that kind of like claymation type of
style. That's fun.
Yeah, and it's basically like an old-timey adventure story. Yeah. Hmm. But the problem is that it's kind of weirdly paced, and you get to the end of it and you kind of just want more of the adventure of them now that they're buds and now that their relationship has been established. You're like, okay, so what's next? And it's like, oh, the movie's over. So, and then I wanted to give honorable mentions to the various superhero movies that came out this year that I thought were very good. Captain Marvel, Avengers Endgame, Spider-Man Far From Home, which I think was my favorite, along with Shazam. Those two, I feel like, were the strongest of the bunch, though I also really liked Endgame. Naomi Scott in Aladdin, I think she is going to be a big star. I think that she kind of proved in Aladdin, and I hope that the Charlie's Angels movie flopping does not hinder that. Also, a shout out to all the people that did amazing memes from the movie Ma, because honestly, I have still not seen Ma, but the meme game from that movie is hilarious.
I wouldn't say that one was necessarily good, but it was entertaining.
Yes.
Octavia Spencer. She's like a psychotic mother.
Yeah. There's some sort of backstory with her and I think the parents of the kids, okay. I want to say, but I still have not seen it.
Oh, me neither. Chris, have you seen Ma?
No,
I haven't. It's kind of like one of those, sure, like, so big, and it's good kind of. It's like entertainment, like mindless entertainment kind of things.
All right, that's cool.
Okay.
And then I'll go through these really quick. Midsommar, I really love the production of it. It was very close to making my top 10, but I still have a few nitpicks about it. Billy Eichner's performance in Lion King, which was the best thing about The Lion King.
Was he supposed
to
be Timon?
Yes, he is Timon. I think Timon was by far the most enjoyable part of that movie.
See, I have no interest in watching that, just because they've just been a frame-by-frame remake of the cartoons. I don't get it, you know?
Yeah.
But well, at least Aladdin felt a little bit new with the music.
It's a little more original than Lion King.
A little bit, but... Yeah.
At least give Timon scenes a watch because he is very enjoyable.
Okay.
I think John Oliver was perfect as Zazu.
Oh, he was pretty good.
You know, perfect casting.
It was good casting for him. And then Hobbs and Shaw, one of the most enjoyable movie theater experiences I've had this year. Honestly, like, we were howling, laughing through almost the entire movie. The old-timey gay bar in the Downton Abbey movie. Shout out to that. honestly, I wanted the whole movie to be just set at the old-timey gay bar because, I mean, it was much more interesting than the rest of it. Also, I had The Lighthouse on my list. The Irishman and Marriage Story, both Netflix movies that were very enjoyable while I was watching them, but I will probably never watch again. And my final thing is two new Christmas movies that came out this year that I think will be future classics, which are Klaus on Netflix and Noel on Disney Plus.
Nice.
Klaus was fantastic,
Klaus?
Yeah.
Okay.
Cool. Nice. I love your list, Rachel.
Very comprehensive. It's very nice.
Love it.
Top 10, guys?
All right, let's do it.
Yes.
All right. So, my top 10, or should we do 10?
You want to do like
10?
Okay.
For me, number 10 is Uncut Gems. Rachel?
My number 10 is Happy Death Day to You.
I love the fact that that made your list.
Honestly, I've seen it twice now. I will probably watch it several more times.
Guilty pleasure.
I think we saw it together, right?
Did we?
Yeah, I think we saw an early screening of it.
Possibly.
And
it was
a good time. I remember really enjoying the first one. I didn't think it needed a second one, but apparently it did.
They're by Blumhouse. They make good stuff.
And I think they don't do anything less than like $5 million. You know, like that's their
wow. That's
like,
good to know.
The budget's
kind of like A24. Yeah. I think they have a very low budget, but great output. Great.
Love it.
All right, so Uncut Gems for me. Happy Death Day to you.
Yes, Happy Death Day.
All right, number 10. Yeah,
The Irishman.
Oh, yeah. I thought it'd be higher on your list.
I did too. At one point it was, just love this movie. It was just the anticipation going into it. I've been following this movie 10 years ago. I remember when the articles first appeared on this movie. I thought it was great performances. Al Pacino was fantastic. Mm-hmm. You know, lately he's been a hit or miss with his work, but it felt like a guy that was younger who wanted to make an acting name for himself again. So that was great. It was also filmed by me in Glendale, so it was kind of cool to kind of see.
And you know, a friend, another critic on the show.
Not to be biased or anything.
Yeah, no. Vinny Bonfanti has been on the show. He made a soy ice cream sundae for Pacino at this old timey restaurant.
Okay.
That was if I'm not mistaken, it was created by my friend, our friend Vinny Bonfanti.
That's pretty cool. Wow, that's a great credit. Yeah, I just thought it was fantastic. I thought it was a great story. I thought the CGI was great. I can understand the controversy of that the younger versions of the characters were a little not on par, but and they also kind of walked like old men, you know. But regardless, I thought it was a great movie. I really did. Yeah.
Good. Mm-hmm. All right, guys. So 6 minutes left. This is sad. We got to
rapid fire.
Karen, number 10 for you.
Probably have to say Marriage Story. I saw it recently. I really liked the performances. Not something I probably watch again, but I thought Adam Driver and Scarlett Johansson had a good dynamic together. Yeah. So
I think it might win best screenplay, best original screenplay. Noah Baumbach, he's a master at the English language, so I hope he gets an Oscar for this. All right, guys, number 9 for me, Honey Boy, Shia LaBeouf, awesome. Okay.
Number 9, I had Us, which I fear came out too early in the year for a lot of nominations.
Yeah.
But Lupita should have been nominated.
It's a crazy movie.
That came out this year, too.
Yeah. Came out around the same time as Glass.
Yeah, so right.
People kind of forgot it. Like, what? It's a little late in the year to remember it.
Yeah.
But, okay, number 9.
Mine is The Laundromat.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's Netflix, right?
Netflix, Steven Soderbergh. Ton of great casts, great commentary on the injustice of the insurance system, and it was just the story, the way that it was told was very unique, and just a great narrative. Yeah.
Okay, Karen.
I had to agree with Us as well.
Us, okay. Yeah. All right, number 8 for me, The Irishman. Rachel.
My number 8 is Uncut Gems.
Nice. Just let's go. Keep going, guys. Yeah.
Just around. so my number 8 is Dolomite Is My Name.
my number 3.
There you go.
Nice.
Love Eddie Murphy in that. I think that is his sweet spot. That's Eddie Murphy that
he's
we
back.
Love.
It's a return to form.
Yep. So keep it up, Eddie.
And there's another movie this year we'll mention in a moment that he is also involved with.
Okay.
Coming to America. Coming to America.
Yes. 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 Oh, I was thinking top 10. I'm like,
Karen.
Ready or Natty.
Okay.
Nice.
Number 7 for me, the overlooked documentary Apollo 11, which basically details the first mission to the moon, to set foot on the moon. I thought it was brilliantly shot. It felt like a fiction, like a feature narrative, but it was real, and it just I think it's the editing was like the best component of it that really tied things together.
Yeah.
And made for a really great. I saw it on a big screen too, so that helps too.
Great, nice.
Yeah.
Good nod to documentary.
Yes, nice. Of course. Number 7.
John Wick Chapter 3 Parabellum. Bring on more
awesome.
John Wick. bring on more of the raid guys in the John Wick world. I'm here for it.
It's great, but after watching it multiple times, it was one of the few like new releases that I saw multiple times this year. It does feel scripted, like the choreography, compared to the other
every
John Wicks.
Scene, every fight scene seems the same.
Yeah.
Oh, I couldn't disagree more.
Okay.
I mean, you have like that big long take. Sorry, we will discuss more off the air.
Oh, okay.
I agree with that. I thought it was really unique fight scenes, but I just feel like as people are coming to Keanu, it's like setup, punch, setup, punch, one at a time. You know. So.
Oh my God! 2 minutes, guys.
Okay.
Sorry.
All right.
We can do this.
My turn.
Yes.
Okay. Ford versus Ferrari.
Okay.
The next one.
7.
Trying to remember which one I had. Beautiful Day in the Neighborhood.
Oh, okay.
That was nice. Good one.
All right. Number 6. Marriage Story for me.
Book Smart.
Okay.
Did not like that one. I thought I would. I wanted to like it, but for some reason, it just. It fell flat with me. Yeah.
We will discuss more.
Yes, I know. Yeah. I know.
Yes.
Sorry. Marriage Story for me.
Okay.
Just a great
we're at 6.
Yeah. Here. Just I really enjoyed it. Yeah. Just a great slice of life.
Okay.
Gone, you know, a ride.
Nice, Karen.
I had to agree with you, Booksmart.
Oh, cool. All right.
Nice.
Number 5 for me, Parasite.
Number 5 for me, Frozen 2.
Nice. I like this.
Love it. Art of Self-Defense.
Nice.
Yeah,
so great. Different, these movies. I love it.
Yeah.
Number 5, Karen?
Jojo Rabbit.
Wow. All different genres and subjects. I love it. Mm-hmm. Okay, number 4, I've got Joker.
Number 4, Knives Out.
Oh.
Talk about honorable mentions. That's an honorable mention I haven't seen, and I would love to see.
Yeah.
I've now seen it twice, and it's even better on the second watch. There's so many little things that you'll pick up on.
Okay.
It's really
awesome.
Wonderful.
Nice. Uncut Gems for me.
Nice.
Yeah. 3? The coveted 3 now.
No, I think 4. Four.
Sorry.
Trying to remember which one I had.
You could just say anything.
I have to say, probably Happy Death Day to you.
Love it.
Perfect. All right. Top 3. Once Upon a Time in Hollywood for me.
Dolomite is my name.
Nice. Ad Strata for me.
Oh, wow. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Just a far out space pick. I love the shooting them up on the moon in the beginning of the movie.
And, yeah.
Yeah, I thought I thought it was a great performance by Brad Pitt. It's a very subtle performance that he should deserve more attention. I think he should get an Oscar for this and not nominated for Once Upon a Time.
Yeah. I didn't love the film. I thought it was more of like a ripoff of 2001, A Space Odyssey.
Really?
Yeah, and the visuals are great, but everything else kind of fell flat. The whole father, son thing with Tommy Lee Jones.
Yeah,
it's kind of.
I liked it. Yeah, I dug it. I smelt what it was cooking.
Agree to disagree. I'll give it another watch, and you'll come back. We'll debate that. Karen, number three for you?
Ford versus Ferrari.
Oh, really?
Matt Damon is
my favorite
actor. So.
It was just a little long for me. Okay. I did like the performances, and actually ILM did the visual effects. I didn't even know that until last night. It looked good. It sounded great. And yeah, I don't know why it's not your best picture, but we'll see. All right, we are at number two for me, 1917.
Little Women.
Nice.
Best American film of the year.
Awesome. Leaving Neverland, documentary about the molestation that Michael Jackson did. And I'll say this about that movie. If you heard the statement, you should separate the artist from the art, this really kind of tells you, hey, like, forget about that statement. And this guy was a monster. It changed my life. I can care less about Michael. I was a huge, fan when I was a kid. But the fact that they took these two stories of these two guys and really did a wholehearted look at the torment and the horror that Michael Jackson, it just really showed that he was a true monster.
So quick question. Would you be a fan if they were to make a Bill Cosby documentary in the same vein?
I would see it,
Finding
Joe. But
kind of the same with the R. Kelly documentary that came out too.
Yeah, it's like the thing about Michael Jackson that's kind of interesting is that I felt like there was so much denial. We were part of the trials and knew that he had this fascination with children, but even to the point of his death, there were still people that were on one side or the other. They were huge fans or just didn't like him. And I feel like this movie really you can't go back and not seeing this movie. You have to, and it's it changes you. It really
separate
does.
Separate the man from the artist.
Yeah, yeah.
Definitely.
Well, I think in this case you can't. I think, not to say that it depends, but it really just discredits that notion. Just given the fact that he was a total creep and monster.
Yeah, I'm going to check it out. Is Macaulay Culkin in it at all?
He was mentioned a little bit. He didn't make an appearance. He was actually, making the argument that he didn't do wrong compared to other cases. So.
Huh. Yeah.
All right. Good
job. He kind of supported him a little bit.
Yeah, gotcha. All right, number two.
Pain and Glory, one with Antonio Banderas.
I watched that last night, actually, as well. Really great performance from Antonio Banderas. Mm-hmm. And was he nominated for an Oscar?
He was, but he's probably going to lose to Joaquin.
Oh, well, yeah, but still a strong performance. All right, guys. So number one, I think I mentioned this every other week. The Peanut Butter Falcon.
Yes.
Shia LaBeouf at his best. He befriends a kid with a 20-year-old man with Down syndrome. Mm-hmm. And they basically go on this journey together. They don't know where the hell they're going. Mm-hmm. They don't know what they want out of life. But the guy with Down syndrome, he knows that he loves this. He idolizes this wrestler played by Thomas Hayden Church. Mm-hmm. So they basically go out, they drive out to meet him. Mm. Very far from where they started. It's a total road dramedy, I'd call it. Mm. And just to meet Thomas Hayden Church, who's running this wrestling camp at his property. And it's just, it's heartfelt, it's serious, it's funny, and the performance is really, really strong.
Yeah, so. Talking about years, I think Shia LaBeouf had a great year this
Honey
year.
Boy was so good as well. Yeah. So those two films, Peanut Butter Falcon, though, that's number one for me. Rachel.
My number one is Parasite. Don't read anything about it before you see it. Just see it.
Experience it.
Yes.
I felt like the marketing on that was kind of off, and you had no idea. I think people think it's a horror movie,
I don't even want to say much about it because it's so wonderful. But if you've seen any of Bong Joon-ho's other films, you know that he has a real heart when it comes to the disenfranchised, when it comes to vulnerable people, and this is absolutely in continuing that vein. Yeah. This is full on about class structure. It's just so good. I can't wait to watch it again.
Yeah, I gotta see that.
Nice,
yeah.
Nice.
For me, it's Once Upon a Time in Hollywood.
Number one.
Just Quentin Tarantino returning to form, in my opinion.
Yes.
His last two movies were in his best, in my opinion. But I just thought it was a great take. You really saw the passion and love that he had for L.A. at that time, Hollywood at that time. I love the fact that he played with history a little bit, and I love this relationship with this stuntman and this washed-up actor, and I love the redeeming qualities that he gives Leonardo DiCaprio's character. That, you know, depending on what you make of the history shift, it really defines this character.
That's kind of a sour note, you know, going back to history and kind of like switching it up.
Yeah.
A lot of audiences weren't really thrilled with that.
Yeah.
But I thought it was a great film as well. So it's number three for me.
Yeah.
Karen, number one.
I have to agree with you. Once Upon a Time in Hollywood.
Yeah, perfect. Yeah, I think we all kind of agree. It's a fantastic film. I think it might win Best Picture.
That'd be cool.
If it does, I won't necessarily be happy about it, but I'll understand how it happened.
Well, you want Parasite to win?
I want Parasite to win. I want Little Women to win.
Well, Little Women for Best Picture, Parasite Best Foreign.
It's not an English movie.
Yeah.
And Little Women's a woman movie.
Yes.
I can't win.
Yeah. I mean, honestly, I would rather see just about any other movie in the category other than maybe Joker. I would rather see win it.
Gotcha. All right, guys, so we're way out of time. So anticipated films for 2020.
Yeah.
Those who know me, Ghostbusters Afterlife, very thrilled to see the original cast back, but in a supporting role. We've got Finn Wolfhard.
Yep.
He's in there. He's gonna probably strap on a proton pack. His sister, I think his sister in the movie, basically has one on. And there's just a great scene in the trailer, if you haven't seen it, where they're in a gunner's seat in the Ecto-1, and it looks like Slimer. We're not quite sure if it is or not, but it's gonna be great. I think it's gonna be great. I hope it is.
I'll list out some films, and I'll just make like one or two words for each film. Tenet, that's the movie that you didn't get in our group chat.
Yep. Oh.
Tenet, Christopher Nolan, Robert Pattinson, it looks really good. This is probably my most anticipated. It's called News of the World.
Hmm.
Okay.
Yes.
Oh, now, Tom Hanks, right? Paul Greengrass, Western.
Wow.
Yep.
There you go. You can't go wrong with
that.
Let's do it. On the Rocks, Sofia Coppola, Rashida Jones, Bill Murray.
Yep.
Say no more.
Nice.
Okay. A Quiet Place 2, follow-up to A Quiet Place. I'm on board. Coming to America, Eddie Murphy on form now. Long-awaited sequel, I'm on board. West Side Story.
Really? I'm curious.
Yes, I'm curious because Spielberg, first time doing a musical, why not? I hope he doesn't mess it up, but probably not. Soul, Pixar. I love the fact that it is them returning to original content, not a lot of sequels.
Yep. Same with Onward.
Onward.
Yep.
I feel like that looks like it's gonna like be like five sequels after this first. It feels
I'm excited for Onward though. It looks like it's gonna have a great emotional center to it. So.
Soul Plus G though.
Christmas.
Yeah. Okay. Greyhound, another Tom Hanks movie, and Blonde, which is Plan B, production company, Brad Pitt's production company about Marilyn Monroe.
Cool.
He's doing great stuff.
He is.
Love Plan B.
Karen, what do you think? Looking forward to?
Big into like horror films, so curious about what they literally like. You mentioned A Quiet Place 2 and so what's going on with that. So
nice.
Yeah.
Cool. Also, Sonic the Hedgehog. I'm kind of curious where they're going to go.
Yeah.
I have feelings about that one.
I'm going to say it's the most anticipated, but I love the fact that Jim Carrey's back to being Jim Carrey.
Yeah.
And I really love the fact that this movie had such a great social response over the character of Sonic. Mm-hmm. The fact that they changed the look and design of the Hedgehog because people were that distraught about it.
Right.
Yeah.
It's great to see that production, that distribution companies are actually acknowledging audiences sometimes.
Should be fun.
Yeah.
Yes. All right, sorry guys, but quick plugs.
Okay, you can find me on Twitter at Rachel E. Kolb. A lot of my writing and stuff is on there. You can also find me weekly talking Disney Plus shows and movies with my friend Cheryl Perlmutter on Facebook Live.
Nice.
You can look at a web series that I'm working on called Four Nationals. You can go to foreignentertainment.com.
I'm just continuing writing for Shakya, like a lot of interviews and movie reviews, a lot of horror, so continuing with that. So.
Karen's great. Yeah. Great perspective, yeah. Great writing.
Thank you. Up.
Yeah.
There you
I
go.
Love reading your work. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah,
yeah, I appreciate
yeah.
that.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Very nice. And, yeah, guys, before we go, I just want to really quick send my condolences to Kobe Bryant's family and friends.
Yes.
He tragically he passed away earlier today, and obviously he's a, you know, he was a great basketball player, a legend, and I just wish him, you know, his family, and everybody who's mourning just, you know, all the best, and, you know, we'll miss him. He's a true legend.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So... All right, guys. Well, I just want to thank you for being here tonight. It's a great show.
Yes, thank you.
We had some great films here, yeah. And hopefully you learned something at home and go to the movies.
So
check out some of these.
Yeah, check
so
out
many
some
movies.
So many. Movies.
Yes.
So, guys,
watch more film. Yes, yes.
More. The great year for film.
You know, yeah, and just one more thing. I know I'm
okay.
out of time, but wow, like. Every year, it seemed like we were just adding a movie or two from streaming, from Netflix. And mm-hmm. now, like, if you saw, like, my whole list was practically Netflix stuff.
Most of it,
so.
Yeah, yeah.
So it's the tides are changing, definitely. So we have to be aware of that as critics. So yeah.
It could be a good thing, could be a bad thing. It just it's depending on how you look at it.
Yeah, sure. For sure.
That's another show, I think.
Yes, yeah.
But, guys, I'm your host, Randy Unger, and I want to thank you all for watching, and we'll be back next week with more movie reviews and interviews. Stay tuned.
Unger the Radar is all new next week with more movie reviews and interviews on Strong Island Radio and Television. Stay tuned. We'll see you next week.